did you always get this question? Where'd you learn to play tennis?
I tell them, I learned to play tennis in Harlem. They say,
Harlem?
Harlem, they got tennis in Harlem?
I heard they kill people there.
You know, if you rewind to when I was a kid, the 80s and 90s in Harlem was not the time to be roaming around. It was a tough neighborhood.
Before them drugs wiped us out up in there, you know how they hit.
You wanted to play black tennis, you came to Harlem. It's kind of like playing basketball in New York and thinking you got game and never played the rucker.
But I'm above the rim and this is how I ball.
You really wanted to bang some balls, you came to Harlem.
Learning tennis as a kid, I didn't know where to go in the wintertime. I lived on 145th Street and Lenox Avenue. The Army's on 142nd. I never knew that there was tennis in the Armory.
They go play at the Armory. I said, the Armory? They got tennis courts in there?
It's this huge structure. Anytime you're going south on the FDR is the only time you'll really kind of pass it unless you hang out in Harlem.
This was where Sugar Ray Robinson and Bumpy Johnson was rolling. It wasn't no juke joint. Whole different scene than the Harlem Armory was happening.
This was a cultural and sports institution that allowed men and women to go and be themselves.
Rain, sleet, snow, no matter how hot it was, I would walk this walk every day to the Armory.
When you'd walk up the steps, there was all the paintings on the wall. You see all these amazing faces. James Blake on the wall.
I loved being there at the Armory. I started doing the programs on Sunday mornings. I don't even remember the age. 6 years old, 7 years old.
So when you walked in, you really felt like you were about to be a part of something great.
It was a place where black people had a prominence.
Take it up.
And they had these major kind of gatherings there.
As-salamu alaykum.
It was the mecca for black tennis because that place, you couldn't have done that in the Bronx. You couldn't have done that in Brooklyn. It was in Harlem.
Althea Gibson, first colored girl to win the top tennis crown. She learned to play in the back streets of Harlem.
Althea Gibson was homegrown. You would think more courts, but we saw a reduction in the courts. And there were only a few places to play.
All the black men that were successful, they were looking for somewhere to go.
Monroe, nice shot by Earl the Pearl.
Earl Monroe said, let's go play. I jumped in his car and I ended up at the Armory.
Mike Tyson came here a couple of times. He said, I didn't know black people even play tennis. So
I remember meeting Arthur Ashe there.
He goes, hi, I'm Arthur Ashe. Can I help you with your serve? I was like, definitely. And David Jenkins, he was a big time tennis player.
So a place where people of color can actually be safe, have their kids be safe.
So I remember coming into the Armory and they were like, there's no tennis today.
One time we fought the city because we lost four of the courts. The place became a homeless shelter for men.
The homeless crisis came up. And because it was declared a state of emergency, they put 1,000 beds in it.
It's easy to do that to black and brown people. If they only have half the facility, they'll be okay.
What story do you want me to tell you? The story that makes white folks happy? The real story?
That was a dark time. That was a hard time for us.
I remember us writing letters to the mayor and stuff to try to get us to come back into playing tennis at the Armory.
Somehow, the kids always won out. Everyone got together and said, this is a special place. You can't mess with this.
That's the way to play. Much better. Good job, guys. Good match.
I just believed in passing tennis on to the next generation and giving them a safe haven.
I was raised by my grandmother. I didn't have a mother and father. So if I wasn't for tennis, man, I don't even want to imagine that.
By the time I was 10, I was drinking over 180 proof rum and was inhaling marijuana.
I was a hoodlum, but then I became a new person.
Good kids are coming out of this and they're going to college.
People got college scholarships coming out of that program, which is like gold.
And nurtured a generation of young people that that turned into incredible human beings and really good tennis players.
Oh, yes.
When I played in program, father was teaching us, James and Thomas was in the stroller.
It was my formative years that we spent so much time there, and there's no question that it's something that is transformational for my life, and I'm sure my brother would say the same thing.
I feel like it transformed as I was transforming, because when I was just a kid and when I was really learning, it taught me that discipline.
We go to the fifth.
I always knew when I was at US Open, I had the Armory cheering for me when I was there. So I know they get tickets, and I could feel that presence.
Success of James Blake then took the program from flying under the radar to being on the radar.
We've been around approaching 50 years, and not many organizations are around for 50 years. That means we're doing something right.
Oftentimes, the heroics and special stories of common Black people is left out of the canon. So this story needs to be chronicled and told and preserved for future generations to understand.
I don't know of any other place that I'm attached to as much as the Armory. And now I'm crying.
I can tell you the program's challenged now.
You know, our ultimate goal is to be able to build our own facility.
If the Armory goes away, the already limited access to tennis is threatened with extinction in the Black community in Harlem. The history is incredibly rich, but the future is also uncertain.